Excuse me. Is it possible to back up in the text a little bit to verse 12? Is that going to be too difficult to do? Okay. What I'd like to do is actually read this text from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, which I think we're very familiar with. It reminds us that our bodies are a temple of the Holy Spirit. Spirit of God dwells in us. Christ dwells in us. And then it reminds us to live in a particular way because of that relationship that we have. Now, this is just one expression of the different ways in the Bible that our Lord shows us that we are in union with Him. And we're going to look at other ways as well. I think the marriage covenant being perhaps the one that's most immediately apparent to us. But there are others as well. But I want us to see as I read this that the fact that we are in union with Jesus calls us to live in a particular way because what we do involves Jesus because He is in us, because we belong to Him, because we're in union with Him. So that tells us on the one hand we need to be careful what we do with Him and how we use what He has given to us, because what we have now belongs to Him. But we're going to see this evening as well that we also need to make sure that we are using what belongs to Him in a way that is honoring to Him. There's always two sides of that picture. Don't do the wrong thing, do the right thing. But in today's mindset, it's because we belong to Him, because He wants to work through us, because He is in us. And we do need to understand that we are involving Him in the things we do because of that. So let me begin by reading 1 Corinthians 6, verses 12 through 20. Paul says, "All things are lawful for me, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food is for the stomach, and the stomach is for food, but God will do away with both of them. Yet the body is not for immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord is for the body. Now God has not only raised the Lord, but will also raise us up through His power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take away the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? May it never be. Or do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one body with her? For he says the two shall become one flesh. But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." Paul doesn't give us just one reason here, but he gives us several reasons why we should give ourselves to serve Him and not give ourselves to sin. So what I want us to look at this morning, again, is this union that we have with the Lord Jesus and what that means. And this evening we'll look at the implications, both good, well, not good and bad, but how we should use then what belongs to us for Him and for His glory, because it really belongs to Him. Well, just again, by way of review, because this is really expanding on a point we looked at last week. Last week, we considered that the Lord has given us the privilege and the right to call on Him for whatever we need. Now, this is one of the blessings of the covenant that He has entered into with us. That covenant is a legal contract, one that is better, as we saw, better than the covenant that God made with Israel when He brought them out of Egypt through Moses. This covenant He makes with us is one in which He not only promises to save us from our sins, but He promises to empower us to do His will, to protect us from our enemies, and to provide us with everything we need. By the way, it's a better covenant than the one that he made with Israel when he brought them out of Egypt, remember, because that covenant did not provide the power to do what the Lord was calling them to do. God wrote his commandments, his law, on tablets of stone, and as long as that law is outside of us, we can't do it. It has to be written on our hearts. It has to be internalized. It has to be something that we're empowered to do by the Holy Spirit. The Mosaic covenant couldn't actually do that. And its whole purpose was really to drive the people of God to the promised seed, that is, of course, the Lord Jesus, who hadn't come yet, in order to find in him the ability to do these things. These blessings of the new covenant were actually given to old covenant believers who looked ahead to that seed, to the Lord Jesus Christ, but the Mosaic covenant itself could not provide it. The new covenant is the fulfillment of everything the Mosaic covenant was showing them they needed, and everything the Abrahamic covenant was promising, and that's the covenant we're in. And so we have these blessings. We have the power to keep it. Now, this contract, this covenant, also means that all of God's promises that he makes to us in the Bible, all of these are guaranteed to us: salvation, protection, provision, ultimate glorification. But it's not guaranteed to us based on what we have done. Not because of our works. Not because we love the Lord. Not because we devoted ourselves to the Lord and made these tremendous sacrifices for him. That's what 1 Corinthians 13 is all about. If I give up all I possess, my body to be burned, but I don't have love, it profits me nothing. It's not because of our love. That love that Paul talks about is the love that he puts in us, and that comes about because of his love to us, because of what Jesus did, because he came into the world as our substitute to meet the conditions, to fulfill the conditions of this covenant, of this contract. He's the one who did what was necessary. He provided the perfect obedience through his submission to the law of God. He made a full payment for our sins on the cross to pay for the debt that we owe to God for our sins. He met the conditions that needed to be met before God could give us the blessing. So these blessings are now guaranteed to us because of what Jesus has done. And we saw that, you know, Jesus, in the work that he has done, has had certain promises made to him as well, certain things that the Father had intended to give to him. And those promises that the Father fulfills to Jesus are actually the promises or the reasons why we get the things he has promised to us. God the Father has promised to Jesus a people and a kingdom. We are that people. And that's why he saves us, and that's why he keeps us, is so that he might give us to his Son in the end. We are Jesus' reward, and we are a part of the kingdom that the Father has given to Jesus. And as the Father subdues Jesus' enemies under his feet, which is one of the promises the Father made to the Son, he is also subduing our enemies under his feet, because Jesus' enemies and our enemies are the same enemies. So we benefit from the promises the Father made to the Son. We will be brought safely to heaven because we are Jesus' reward. Now, we also saw that these things are guaranteed to us because we are in union with Jesus. We are united with him. That's what we want to look at today. We are joined together with him. What belongs to him belongs to us, and vice versa. What Jesus has done, as we've already seen through several examples this morning, we have done. When he obeyed in our place, we obeyed in him. When he died, we died with him. When he rose, we rose with him. When he ascended, we ascended. Because he will inherit, we too will inherit. Those are the blessings that come to us through our union with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the application that we looked at last week that I don't want us to forget is this, and then we'll look forward to what we're looking at this morning. Since the Father has made these promises to Jesus and to us in Jesus, let's not forget to do what it is we saw the psalmist doing last week, and that is to look to him for the things that we need and to remind God of his covenant, so to speak. again remembering that God never forgets his covenant. But we forget it. We often forget it, particularly at those times when we need it the most. God has all this help. He has all these promises. He has all these blessings stored up. And he says, just look to me, and I will give them to you. But we forget to look because we're like Peter. We're looking at the wind and the waves. We're looking at the situation, and we begin to sink. And as long as we look at the situation, we're going to continue to sink. But when we remember the promises that God has made us in the Lord Jesus Christ, we look to him, and we call out to him. And as Jesus pulled Peter out of the water at that particular moment, so the Lord will do for us. But we do need to remember the covenant, and we need to look to him. Now today, let's develop this theme of our union with the Lord Jesus Christ. The fact that it guarantees the blessings of the covenant is really just one of its many applications. But before we look at some of the other applications, which is what we're going to look at this evening, I want to explore a bit further what we mean by union with Jesus Christ, what it is. Now, first of all, we need to remember that it is not something we came into the world with. We didn't have it, but something the Lord brought about in our lives at a particular time when, in his mercy and in his grace, he caused us to be born again. That's the time when the union actually begins. Now, remember, we came into this world outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul describes what our condition was like in different areas in Scripture. Ephesians chapter 2, he gives us a fairly full exposition of it. Before we get to the particular text that I was going to read, a little further in this chapter, he talks about how we were strangers to God, we were aliens to the covenants of God, we were far off, and we were without hope. That's how we came into the world. But another consequence of the fact that we came into the world this way is the fact that we came into the world dead, spiritually dead. Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins. By the way, Paul will go on to say, not only them, but also himself. It's true of everybody coming into the world. Dead, not just partially alive, not, you know, deathly sick, with still a little bit of ability to do what God wants us to do, enough to reach out and receive the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, dead. Now, he's not saying that we're physically dead. I want you to notice here, he's not saying that our heart wasn't beating. He's not saying that we weren't breathing. He's not saying that we couldn't walk or talk or do a number of things. We could tie our shoelaces. We could work. We can eat. We could do all kinds of things. But sadly, everything we did was bad. Not formally bad, not maybe in its form. We might have done some things that outwardly look good, but everything we did not have the right motive. We didn't do it for God's glory, and we didn't do it because we loved God. Okay, so we could do things, and we could even do things that outwardly were good, but we couldn't do anything that was inwardly good. We could not glorify God. We were spiritually dead. We didn't have the Spirit. That's what this means. We could not please God for the very reasons I've just mentioned. We didn't love him. We didn't want to glorify him. And even the things we did that were right were done for the wrong reasons. Like everybody else who comes into the world, all we wanted to do was to please ourselves and not the Lord. And that is the reason why we were alienated from him, the reason why we were the children of wrath like the rest of the world. Paul continues in verses 1 through 3 of Ephesians 2. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Now, I do want you to notice that this is what Paul tells us was our condition. Regardless of what we might have thought we were like, this is, in fact, what we were like. And I think as we is after the Lord saves us and we continue on for a while and we kind of look back at our lives and we understand our lives and our hearts a little bit more, we see a little bit more, actually more and more, how this is true. This is what we were. And in this condition, we could not please God. But, of course, when in His mercy He sent His gospel to us, and when further in His mercy, we not only heard the gospel preached outwardly, there's a lot of people who hear the gospel who are never saved. When in God's mercy, He sent the gospel and also sent that which we needed in order to be saved along with the gospel, which was His Holy Spirit, to issue that inward call and to raise us to life, the Spirit joined us with the Lord Jesus Christ. He united us with Jesus Christ in the first sense in which we understand union with Jesus. We were outside of Christ. The Spirit of God, when the gospel was preached to us, united us to Jesus. He plugged us into Jesus, who is the source of life. And He created what we call a vital union with Jesus. The word vital means life-giving. As I mentioned as an illustration of this before, when you have an appliance, you know, and it's sitting on the the kitchen counter. If it's not plugged in, it doesn't have any power, it can't operate, can't do anything. And we were like that at one time. We were like appliances that didn't have any power. We weren't plugged in. But the Spirit of God comes along and He plugs us in. He plugs us into Jesus. And it's at that moment when that union with Jesus and His life takes place that we actually began to live. This is what brought us to life, raised us from spiritual death to life. And that's what Paul is talking about as he continues in Ephesians 2 in verses 4 and 5. But God, being rich in mercy, because of His great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. So this is one of the things we mean when we talk about union with Jesus, union with Christ. The Holy Spirit unites us to Him, causes His life to flow through us, a living, as it were, electricity, and raises us to spiritual life. You know, this life that flows through us, through our union with the Lord Jesus Christ, Paul tells us in our passage that that life is actually the Spirit of God Himself. This is something else that, if I'm going to make a plug for Sinclair Ferguson's study, that he brought out in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 17. He writes this, "But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with Him." Now, you'll notice, if this is reflecting what at least is in my particular version, translation of the Bible, the NASB, the word spirit there is lowercase. Ferguson points out this should be uppercase. This should be the Holy Spirit. And it's true, because we do share in the same Spirit. So that this joining together with the Lord Jesus Christ actually comes about by faith, but when that happens, we become a partaker of the same Holy Spirit that Jesus was anointed with, the same Spirit that is basically that bond of union between the Father and the Son, as Jesus prays in John chapter 17, that we may all be one, even as He and the Father are one. The bond of that union is the Holy Spirit. That is the life of Christ within us, His presence within our souls, His work within us, making us to be like Jesus, which I mentioned at the beginning of this as we're heading into this earlier on, as I was telling you about what Sinclair Ferguson was talking about last week, the groaning of the Holy Spirit. He is within us, working within us, groaning and longing that we might become like our Lord Jesus Christ. This is what creates this new spiritual life. And the result, of course, is that we will live a different kind of life. The kind of life Paul is describing here, and the kind of life we're going to be looking at this evening. We are no longer going to live for self, for sin, and for pleasure, but now we are going to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is going to continue His work through us. But there is another kind of union that we share with Jesus, and that's the one that we often focus on. Once the Spirit makes us alive, once we are plugged into Christ and the Spirit of God is in us and we've been raised to spiritual life, at that very moment, we immediately look to Jesus as he is presented to us in the gospel, and we trust in him. We trust in him to save us. We trust in him to rule us. We might say more accurately, we submit to him. The Spirit opens our eyes, and he shows us the beauty of the Lord Jesus Christ, how suitable he is as a Savior, that he is what we need. And our hearts immediately go out to him. We begin to love him. We want him as our Savior. I mean, what's the difference between the people who hear the gospel that don't receive Jesus and the people who hear the gospel that do receive Jesus? The big difference is some of them want him and some of them don't want him. But the reason why some want him is because of the Holy Spirit. It's easy to explain why some don't want him. It's because of the sin of their hearts. They do not love God. They do not want to glorify him. And so we begin to love him. We want him as our Savior when the Spirit of God opens our eyes and we receive him and we rest in him and in his work alone to make us acceptable to God. Now, in this opening of our eyes to what is really beautiful in the Savior, we also begin to see that what we were doing before, the way we were living before, wasn't as good as we actually thought it was after all. We begin to see sin the way the Lord sees it, and we want to turn away from it. Sadly, we don't, it's not with our whole hearts. We have a divided heart, that's why the struggle is there. But now we have this love for what is good, and so we begin to go that direction. We begin to turn from it. And of course, when we see the glory of the Savior and his majesty and his power and his authority, and we see the beauty of that as well, it makes us want to bow the knee to him, to stop fighting against him, to give up the control of our lives and to give him the controls of our lives. Now, at the very moment that this takes place, and we're talking about things that all happen in a moment, these are not like several steps that there are years in between. It's life comes, eyes are turned on, trust is immediately there, submission is immediately there. At that very moment, all these things are taking place. The moment of faith and repentance, we become united to Jesus Christ in another way, and that is legally. That's when we enter into covenant with him in this contract that we've been looking at. We receive the blessings Jesus purchased for us in the new covenant. And here is where we begin a relationship, again, through this union that actually entails a sharing in each other's possessions. Now, as I've said, we usually think about this in terms of what it is that belongs to him that actually becomes ours. And we'll look at that now, but I do want us to see this evening what belongs to us also becomes his. Now, this means, first of all, that all that belongs to him becomes ours, everything we need. We were sinful. His atonement becomes ours. It washes us and cleanses us. We were naked. We had no righteousness. His righteousness clothes us as this perfect, spotless garment that is going to pass the judgment of God. His reward becomes ours. And that would be the Spirit of God. That would be everything we need in this world. And would also mean the kingdom, the eternal kingdom that one day he is going to inherit, and we also will inherit with him. Paul writes in Romans chapter 8, verses 16 and 17, "The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, heirs also, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him." That is, if we are willing to endure what we must endure as believers in this world, because if we live godly lives, we will suffer. If we're willing to do that, it shows that we really are children. And if we really are children, we are the joint heirs of Christ. And when he inherits the kingdom, we'll inherit it too because of our legal union with Jesus. So what is his becomes ours. And what is ours becomes his by covenant, becomes legally his. Now, one thing we do need to recognize is that we already belong to him. As a matter of fact, that's what we read in Psalm 100. Remember, he created us. And because he created us, we belong to him. We are his. He has sovereign right over everything that he has made, the whole universe, everything belongs to him. But when we are united to Jesus, we do become his in another sense. We become his people by way of covenant. Now, if I may, the Lord gives to us many illustrations of that union with the Lord Jesus Christ in Scripture. And I think perhaps the most striking one is marriage, because that is how our relationship with Jesus is actually expressed in Scripture, how it's represented. Our union with him is like a marriage covenant, a marriage contract, where a man and a woman are united together. They come together and they're in union with one another. They become one. Now, that union means a couple of different things. First of all, it means that the husband and wife, the man and the woman, share one life. They set themselves apart exclusively to one another. The Bible says, Paul actually says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, that they belong to each other and only to each other, and that this is true for the whole of their lives. And that's why, of course, why adultery is such a serious sin. When you take what belongs to someone else and you give it to someone it doesn't belong to. Now, the same is true in our union with the Lord Jesus Christ. He sets himself apart to be ours, to be our husband. And we set ourselves apart to be his bride. We are each other's forever. And that's why it is such a serious sin when we are joined to the Lord Jesus Christ to join ourselves to others or to anyone else or to anything else. As, you know, again, that supplants the Lord Jesus Christ. We have one example of that, of course, in our text this morning. But it could apply to anything that we put in the place of Jesus in our lives as our Lord and as the first in our lives. There will be no other gods before the true God. Idolatry is spiritual adultery. We are married to Christ. We need to be faithful to him. Now, in marriage, a man and a woman are also joined in another sense. Whatever belonged to them individually now belongs to them corporately. Now they share in each other's property. And the same thing happens in our union with Jesus. He gives us what belongs to him, and we give him what belongs to us, and we share those things. Now, that's why Paul uses, again, Jesus' union, his relationship with us, as a model for marriage, because marriage is really a picture of that union that we have with Jesus. He writes in Ephesians 5, verses 22 through 30, "Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body." So again, here you have the idea that our union with the Lord Jesus Christ is essentially a marriage. And the marriage that You know, covenants that we have on earth really reflect the kind of relationship that Jesus has with us. We become one, one flesh, and we also share all things in common, and there's a mutual respect and care for one another. Now, Paul represents our union with Jesus in other ways. He uses the image of a temple in our passage. In 1 Corinthians 6:19, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own?" We are like so many living stones that are being built together as a temple that we might offer to God spiritual worship. Peter continues in 1 Peter 2, verses 4 and 5, "And coming to him as to a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices to God through Jesus Christ." So this is the image of a marriage. There's the image of a temple. But there is also one other image that perhaps is used very often in Scripture, at least as often as the marriage, and that is when Paul represents our union to Jesus as that of a body to a head. We become one body with the Lord Jesus, His body. We already read in Ephesians 5:30, we are members of His body. And by the way, that's the reason why He loves us and cherishes us, as a husband is to do his wife. Paul will say later in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, in verses 12 and 27, this: "For even as the body is one and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are one body, so also is Christ. Now you are Christ's body and individually members of it." So this is what it means to be in union with Jesus. We have this vital union with Him. We have this legal union with Him, which is like a marriage, which is like being joined together with Him as a body is joined together with the head. Jesus is the head, and we are His members. The Spirit is the one who creates this union with the Lord Jesus. Remember again what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6:17, "But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with Him." And this word "join," from which we get the word "union," means to unite closely, and it can also mean to glue together, taking two things and putting them together, gluing them together so that they stay together. Well, the Spirit is the glue that unites us with Jesus. He is the bond we have with Jesus. And we, by that union with Him, will be glued to Him forever. Now again, that's why we enjoy the blessings of the new covenant. That's why we're saved. That's why we're never going to be lost. That's why we're going to see heaven. Because the Holy Spirit has glued us to Jesus, and He is the glue. Now, this evening, we're going to look at some of the practical implications of this. Again, this morning, we're saved. We have all these blessings because of the covenants, because of our union with Jesus. That's what Jesus has becoming ours. But we do need to understand that now being His body, His members, being His bride, being His temple, and all these other images we could use means something else too. Jesus wants to use this body, the body of Christ, us as individuals. He wants to use us to do certain things. And He also doesn't want His body to be used for certain things. So it's going to remind us why we need to avoid sin and why we need to give ourselves to do what the Lord has called us to do. So that's what we're going to focus on this evening. But for now, as we close, I do want us to remember that the reason why we're in union with Jesus is because of the infinite love of the Father in giving us His Son, and the infinite love of the Son towards us, His bride. He came into the world to save His bride. We are His bride. And the table reminds us of that love and what He was willing to give to us as our husband to enter into this union with us so that we might have these blessings, and so that He might use us to give him glory. So let's think about that as we prepare to come to the table as well. Let's spend just a few moments in prayer and ask the Lord to prepare us to rejoice in this union and to come to the table in a way that would be honoring to our husband.